Okay, welcome everyone. This is Francis Petit, Associate Dean for Global Initiatives and Partnerships for the Gabelli School of Business. And we are in the midst of International Business Week. The date is April 1, 2020. And the circumstances are such that everyone is home and self-quarantine themselves due to the coronavirus COVID-19 pandemic. So we're having this event via Zoom, and we look forward to the discussion. The session is called The Sustainable Economy During Crisis with a discussion about COVID-19. And we have two esteemed guests. We have Mr. Marco Casiraghi and Mr. Andrea Mennillo. And before passing it on to our esteemed guests, I just would like to just tell you a little bit about our guests and also discuss the format of today. Mr. Andrea Mennillo is a board member and president of various financial institutions in Italy, France, Germany, Portugal, Spain, UK, and Switzerland. He's also an advisor to the Ministry of Finance in Italy. He is the founder and managing director of IDA Capital, which is active in business diplomacy. And he has lectured on the university level for many schools internationally, including Fordham University. He is the vice chair of the Fordham London Centre, as well as an executive member of the Gabelli School of Business Advisory Board. And he is also the recipient of the Gabelli School of Business 2018 International Awareness Award. In addition, we have Mr. Marco Casiraghi, who is the president of Engeco, a civil construction company in the Principality of Monaco. He is a board member for many companies and joint ventures in the United States, Europe, the Middle East, and China. He is involved in many nonprofit activities and has started business games at school to promote entrepreneurship and enterprises with high school students. He has also designed and organized every year the Monaco Mousetrap Car Grand Prix to promote science and engineering. He has also lectured frequently within many universities internationally as well. So we're very delighted to have our esteemed guests. And the way, in terms of the format, the way this will work is first Mr. Casiraghi will speak about his position on sustainability, the sustainable economy, and we can have a Q&A afterwards. And in terms of the Q&A, you can obviously speak, or you can put it in the chat. And then afterwards, Mr. Mennillo will discuss the global economy and how he, in the sustainable economy, and how his thoughts on COVID-19 and its impact. So with that said, I'd like to pass it on to our esteemed guests, Mr. Mennillo and Mr. Casiraghi, please.
Marco? Are you there?
He's on mute.
Oh.
Marco, you're on mute.
You are mute. Meantime, Francis, I would like to thank you to invite us. I've been such a great supporter of the International Business Week. We have done, I tried to give a little contribution over the last few years. And thank you again to ask me to join this wonderful week for our students. Unfortunately, this year, COVID-19, according to the rules which are effective in the state of New York and globally are affecting our social life, we are doing this on Zoom. But I have to beg pardon because I took this, I thought it was a tie-less conference. So I'm sorry. And even if during my speech I have two dogs, and maybe sometimes they come to tap me, so I'm sorry that sometimes you will hear someone barking, but it's not my daughter, but one of my two dogs. Okay.
All positive.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
I think I have unmuted my position. Can you hear me? Hello?
Yes.
Very well. Very well now.
Okay. Good. So before starting going through the sustainability and the crisis, just a couple of additional words on my CV. From an academic point of view, I am basically an engineer. So I did my master in mechanical engineering after studying what in Italy is more a liberal art kind of position. So I had to study for 5 years ancient Greek and Latin for 8. But after I made another 80 degree changes and I went to what is best Italian engineering school. Many, many years ago, my doctoral thesis was on a climate model simulation that in the 70s was something relatively new. So consequently, I had always a passion to try to understand something about the climate. But apart from my obviously super obsolete today model of climate simulation, I would like then really to go through and why I mentioned I was and I'm still an engineer as basic academic background, but after I moved obviously to management, and I was really lucky to be able to work in many different countries all around the world. So now and make really experience on different culture, different way of approaching the problem, and maybe we will have occasion to talk later. Going back to the main subject, sustainability and crisis, it may be worth mentioning a couple of words about crisis. When basically I had the age of the student of Fordham today, so back in the mid-70s, we were really into a significant crisis. There was really, in fact, a group, was in fact called the Group of Rome, that probably Andrea remember, was head by Mr. Petit, who was really extremely afraid that the world was depleting all the resources. So he was really totally afraid of the fact that the world was running out of oil, was running out of main resources. It was a tough time over there for some other potential. There was a lot of people was talking about the nuclear winter as a possible threat. But we had really many other, we had acid rain in Europe. Europe was full of acid rain that was damaging the European forest. So there was really a significant crisis in those days. We went through after some other crises, and obviously it's not now we need to focus on the current one. But there is one characteristic that to some extent is worth mentioning. Crisis could be, if you make a parallel with Christianity, could be like the purgatory from the Christianity, in the sense that you have the opportunity really to repent and then go the right way and go into the paradise of growth again. And this has happened so far all the time. All the time we came out of this crisis really better. So there was really the opportunity, and if you see, from 1975 to today, if my memory is not wrong, the GDP of the world is now the double, something like that. And everything is really, there was a fantastic growth out of in the past 40, 50 years. But also the poverty has been really decreased dramatically. I think that today, the child mortality is also considerably less, maybe less than 50% than what it was really 50 years ago. So this, I think, is a point that need really to take into consideration. There are also some other elements that if you see, even out of big crises like the Second World War, the world went through a fantastic period of growth. Really, we had a couple of decades, the 50s, the 60s, all over, especially in the Western world, we had really a fantastic growth. The crises are fantastic opportunity for the people, so not for everybody, only for people that is able to see, but this is not enough. So we have a lot of intellectuals are able really to see, but you need to see and act at the same time. So you need to avoid really the paralysis of analysis, and really you need to be able to move into action. Now coming to the current crisis, now is 6 weeks, and in particular, obviously Italy, my country, went after China first into this type of situation. And now there are some interesting things to see. If you see the water of Venice now, they are unbelievable because there are really a lot less movement in the water of Venice. The level of pollution, so if you see all the Po River Valley that really to down to the Adriatic Sea, that is an area where most of the, where 50% again of the Italian GDP is produced around this valley. Today, the level of pollution went considerably, 20-30% of CO2, but also the other really big decrease significantly. I was also reading that even in New York, even if the situation is started considerably after, probably a couple of weeks after Italy, the university has published some data also over there, the level of pollution also going really considerably down. So this is something good. This is the proof that some elements are possible really to decrease it. The problem, because this type of situation has happened also in the last crisis that we had, 2008-2009. So we had a decrease of some of the pollution. Fortunately, to some extent, we went through purgatory, but the level of changing of our action was not really sufficient. To some extent, because also out of the current problem, there are two way out. There is an easy one that goes back to the normal way of, so consequently some of the government can throw into the existing or past way. So one easy way after giving money to full using the same of steel are the biggest producer of CO2. So from a point of view, there are really, now is the time for the government, the public opinion, really pressurized to go the other way. Because the other way, it is possible. So this is one of the key problem that also Andrea has heard me repeating many times. We do not need to wait for the invention of extraordinary new technology. A lot of things already exist. The problem is that they are not applied. They are not applied sufficiently. And the reason to go further with the application of existing technology is a pressure from the public opinion and also from the scientists, but also from some enlightened politician, because the decision is in the end of the politician, who can really and go the easy way or the old bad way. That has produced a lot of progress, as I was mentioning, so it's not really totally bad about the past. So we have really to try to avoid and to throw everything away. There have been fantastic progress. It is possible to do a lot better. The technology exists and everybody, compared to the prior crisis or situation, when you see 20 years ago, people, they were complaining for the future and so on. And today, everybody is trying really to come into the market with electric car. Solar also is a kind of situation where a lot of progress. I don't know if question to a lot of people in Italy, if you ask to the Italian, if you think during a Sunday, during the day, what percentage of electricity produced in whole Italy, 60 million people, so not a small country, is produced from renewable energy. Today, already, Italy has made progress in that respect because close to 80% of the electricity on Sunday, during the day, not during the night, obviously, is produced by using renewable energy. So, and it's possible really to do a lot more. Now, why those type of things are not really applied? Because people tend to repeat and to continue to do things as in the past. Copy and paste is unfortunately an easy way to apply what you have always done. There are possibilities of new technology that are there, so they are not unproven. So it's just a question of applying those technology. And some became really considerably cheaper compared to the prior crisis of 2008-2009. So consequently, there are the possibility, but we have really to push in this direction. And obviously, more attention and more possibility that are available need at this point to be pressurized. So I hope that this is an occasion to go through this purgatory and repent and do better, even better than what we have done in the past. Now, some in this direction, something specific for the student in terms of what I can draw in terms of past experience as an engineer who has moved into management many years ago, but they're not lost. You know that in production, first as an engineer. And now, one of the things that I have noticed very, very, very often is that analysis of the option. Yes, you do some sensitivity analysis in several projects looking at return on investment, and you see variation, volume, prices, and so on. But there is not really enough analysis of which project from a sustainability point of view, in terms of today, there are really opportunities that have similar kind of return on investment, even with traditional way of computing cost return, but they are not really properly. And consequently, this is what the different board or even your student most probably will really go through a career as manager, as financial manager, then as CEO of company and so on. So you have to ask, you have to be tough with the end. You have to ask, and you need to be persistent, so don't give up. Finally, since I'm approaching the time, I want really to leave space to the course of some my experience. So if I have to extract three or four kind of the first one is that you need to study. You need to be damn good. So there are no alternative to competence. That is no alternative. So if you are not a good student or an excellent student, it is something that at the end, without knowledge, you will not go anywhere. So the first advice will be to study, to be damn good. Second is really to focus on something. and don't spare your energy too many directions. Just focus and act, as I was saying. You have to really at one point make a selection, make a decision, and really move into that. Being able to manage properly your time, not to be really dedicating in a proper way, because you need really to see and dedicate some time to the tradition. But at the same time, you need to look at the future also, because there is really no progress without tradition and innovation. So you totally forget the experience of the past. You don't go anywhere if you have only just on innovation to the past experience. To finish, to the student, the last advice or pill of advice that come always to my mind is something that I said many ago, approximately 500 years ago. He said that in life, the real risk is to set ambitious goal and not make it. The real and true risk is to set too low, too easy objective and reach them. So this, since we live only once, so, and definitely we need, and so I would like really to push your study to your student to study, but also to be very ambitious, to have a very high goal in life. So basically, this is what I think, coming really close to minute, and leave eventually some space to question.
Thank you, Marco. I think you may have inadvertently turned off your camera.
Camera?
Yeah, you might have inadvertently turned off your camera. So yes, you're back. Yes, you're so thank you for your thoughts. And I received a question privately on the queue, but I also wanted to open it up to see if there was questions with the students. One question is, If the leaders can go back to business as usual, is that the easy alternative?
Yes, it's easier because obviously last night I was really following the Trump briefing, the usual late afternoon briefing, and to some extent, I had also the impression that there was the initial approach of trying to go the easy way and just launch an infrastructure kind of project without really looking for some of the alternative that today exist in having a more sustainable, more circular kind of economy. It is possible. They are there. Not everything, so we cannot be stopped, but in certain areas we need to go on.
Is there any questions from the audience, from the students and our visitors?
Hi, Marco, this is Donna Rapaccioli, the Dean of the Business School. Thank you for participating. I have my camera off because my bandwidth when there's a big group is not good. My question is, you know, you mentioned using existing technologies and not to worry so much about finding new technologies to solve some of our challenges. Could you give an example of maybe an existing technology that could be repurposed in a beneficial way?
Well, certainly are available in one is definitely if you've seen the construction business, for example, and there are differences between Europe and United States, take the issue of wood for a high-rise building, something up to 11 or 15 floor, is technologically possible. Wood is a fantastic material for storage of CO2. Second, today, the cost of really building a 15-floor, 12-floor building in wood and versus the traditional cement and steel is very similar, but there are not really many. In the state, obviously, for the residential housing, you have a lot of wood applications, something that in Europe is not like that. Well, in Europe, really small residential, one or two floor, they are all built using cement and brick and mortar type of. So this, to me, is, if I have to say one, this is the technology that is not properly used. And it exists. Then when you move into the mechanical and electrical installation that you have in building, over there, a lot of application is tend to be really use what you have always done, while there are in fact a lot of possibility of using in the case of air conditioning, for example, and this is something that in some of the European country they use ground source heat pump. So basically, and this is done in very cold places like Sweden, Finland, or even in Switzerland. If you go up in the mountains, you don't see many chimneys today with smoke coming out, even in the rich part of Switzerland, in Gardena and St. Moritz. They are using ground source heat pump. So they have really a series of pipe in the ground, and the ground has a much higher temperature. If you drill just a few meters below, the temperature of the ground is a lot higher than the temperature in the air. Consequently, the heat pump doesn't move, in fact, the heat from the air into the residential room, but is moving the heat from the ground to from a much closer source. Consequently, is much more efficient. Those are two existing technology. The other obviously has to do application on solar panel that today in a lot of places have reached parity with in term of cost per cents for kilowatt hour with conventional, and they are not today applied as frequently as it should be possible to do.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Marco. There's just one more, but I think you kind of answered it in the end in terms of the other, you touched on cheaper forms of energy that have been identified. Do you know if these potentially in the long term can be cheaper than solar? That's the question on the queue.
Sorry, I've not understood the question. Cheaper than solar, what?
Yeah, less expensive than solar energy. These other forms of energy.
I have not understood. I mentioned that today, solar energy to produce electricity today is in most country is compared to the conventional fossil fuel, burning coal or burning oil or burning gas, the cost is competitive today. So you can produce electricity, and I mentioned the case of Italy today that is producing a very large proportion of the total electricity just using the solar.
Thank you. Are there any other questions before we pass along to Mr. Mennillo? Thank you, Marco. Thank you, Mr. Casiraghi. So we're going to now pass on the program to Mr. Mennillo, who's going to discuss kind of the financial impact, global markets, et cetera, but obviously what this virus can potentially do. So here's Mr. Mennillo.
Thank you, Francis. I have a question afterward for Mr. Casiraghi, because his address was, as usual, inspirational. Me, on the other side, I'm not talking about something good, so I try to make it a little bit easier, because talk about the big problems that we had in the last century, and now it's not an easy game for me. I don't want to make an history address, but let me just to point out the few big crises we have lived and our fathers have lived in the last now 100 years. You remember the Great Depression? We are talking about the years 29 to 39, and was at the time no clear how the monetary instruments were not, the monetary tools, they were not properly mastered. So we had the stagflation and we had the big crisis. Was brilliant, the answer. President Roosevelt with the New Deal, great to even to the support of one of the major minds in economy, Mr. Keynes. He launched the New Deal, who revitalized the U.S. economy, and for the first time revealed the government's role in the management of the nation economy. Then after that, we had the war. The war, World War II was the deadliest military conflict in history. Over 70 million people killed. 30 countries were involved. U.S. War spending bill added around $230 billion to the debt. But on the other side, during wartime, a lot of economy have benefits, so there was a good rebound. Because of all the company corporates were converted to military or military-related businesses. At the end, in this period, we can, at the end of this period, we can consider one of the crucial, pivotal moment in the financial history, which is the Bretton Woods agreement. With the Bretton Woods agreement was created a number of institutions that these days are frequently on the news. The World Bank, the International Monetary Fund, which provide the technical assistance and short-term loan to prevent financial crisis in member countries, usually. We had an important recession in the United States in 73 and 75, was related to the oil embargo. But again, the stagflation again was pretty tough. And but again, the economy was able to rebound without big government stimulus. We have a bigger recession because it was related with this so-called Cold War from 80 to 89. But again, the role now of the United States was as the most important country economically and militarily in the world. So the government, they were used to exploit the monetary, the politic monetary tools to increase the monetary mass to support and to make smoother the troubles related to the crisis. Now we get back to two crises that we are more familiar, especially our students. We were there, so we remember very well. We are talking about what happened in 2001 and culminated in the horrible 9/11 events. The Economic Growth and Tax Relief Reconciliation Act was the answer from the Bush administration to the recession. The United States and the world needed a war, because after 9/11 a war started to rebound. Then we had the pure financial world, which is still is recalled by many of us, is the bank crisis. It was called by the housing industry's downturn. The financial institution, for greed, for ambitions, they invest heavily, manipulating information. And when the problem started to roll, we had a big change in the financial institution panorama. I'm talking about Bear Stearns or Lehman. A very important program was established, was the TARP, the Troubled Assets Relief Program, who lasted until 2010. And many big corporations took benefit from the investment made by the government, who support buying preferred stock to the 8 major leading banks. I think was a great success, because some of the companies who were in the market, they were able to do. One example for everybody was AIG, that is true, is completely reshaped, but now is again a big company, very important in the market. Under the Obama presidency was launched another American Recovery and Investment Act, who added again around $800 billion in budget deficit by 2019, so recently. Now we are in a time where the use of the quantitative easing has been very, very efficient, has been used for pure political and government level objectives, thanks to the fact that we had very qualified and successful leader in the major banking institutions. And last but not least was Mr. Draghi, who, like you, was educated in a Jesuit schools in Italy. We were able to manage using the print of new money properly done as a moment to support. We are living in the last few years, and even the United States enjoyed a very successful years in the business side. Now we arrive at the beginning of this year. This plague who is affecting the world is not a financial or economic crisis. is clearly an horrible disaster. Any country in the world will pay its debt toll. And in my opinion, will affect dramatically even the social behaviors. Some industries will be completely destroyed because in our mind, we will be we will be, of course, concerned for so long to behave as it was in the past. People will be more and more careful in the future, going out, living with other people. You can imagine what happened, I don't know, the cruise, for instance, the cruise ships, what's going to happen. We realize that the health system all over the world, they were not prepared to a pandemic disease. We're not prepared because the key point in this situation are the intensive care infrastructure. Any country in the world was not prepared. So we had to, but the reaction I think is good, and it was thanks to the military culture, because thanks to the armies, most of the country, they have been able to set up intensive care program all over in each country. But this will be a political crisis. Now we go through it, talking about especially Europe. In the US already the government, of course in US there is a political crisis because United States are heading to a presidential election. So every decision, of course, is considered to be an active or effective move toward the election. You guys, Swiss Democrat, thinks that the virus, it's a responsibility of the Republican, and even I heard many Republicans say that are the Democrats to it. So it becomes a little bit funny, in my opinion, but this is typical before a such important election. I would say, let me stress one point, for instance, what's happening in Hungary, which is a small country from your point of view, but is a very old country with big traditions. And there is the president democratically voted by the people asking for a full power without referring to anybody. So this is, and Hungary is part of Europe, is part of NATO. And so it's very, this is a concerning point politically wise. Let me spend a few words about the United States stimulus against the COVID-19 crisis, because after the health crisis, we will have definitely an economic and a social crisis. The Federal Reserve announced that it would revive the quantitative easing, which has been very popular in Europe in the last few years, and would purchase $500 billion in treasury and $200 billion in mortgage-backed security of the next several months. Because clearly the crisis will impact the company and the economy, the banks. Financial institution, the students, even you are, most of you are advanced student, they know very well. The banks provide the blood to the backbones, which is the different type of economies. So if there is an economic crisis, will impact the credit ability of the banks, and it will impact the ratio, the equity, the patrimonial ratio for the banks. You have seen that in the last few weeks, the market capitalization for major financial institutions around the world has been impacted dramatically. So for sure, there is also a concern for the different countries not to allow aggressive takeover from outside. This is another point. Now, thanks to the drop in the market capitalization, what's going to happen? For sure, in Europe, even Europe is very divided, but we are going to talk about this. Europe is thinking to introduce, we use it during the first privatization of major state government-owned company, the golden share, because French, Italy, Spain, Germany as well, they will use it to prevent aggressive takeover on strategic companies, and some of them are, of course, banks or financial institutions in general. I think we will see that we are they are not political manifesto. Countries, even countries, the Anglo-Saxons, so United States and the UK, they are prepared to send a check to each household, because if this crisis will not be overcome on the medical side, of course, we're going to expect that a lot of people will lose their job. And so we, again, we are going to a sort of military post-war scenario. I'm sorry that I'm giving you only bad news, but this is the same approach that most of European countries are having, Spain, France, Italy. I'm not talking about the smaller, like Greece, Portugal. They were already in a financial crisis. But Europe, if on one side is announced several monetary stimulus measure, there is a big political issue. Is previewed the ECB, the European Central Bank, announced an additional 128 billion in bond purchase over the course of 2020. Will be losing the capital requirements on banks, allowing them to lend more to support businesses. The interest rate will be lowered, and the easing of a lending requirement for its target long-term refinancing operation. Just a few days ago, the ECB announced again an asset purchasing program called the Pandemic Emergency Purchase Program. Again, ECB asked not to pay dividends and authorize buyback share. We are, there is a very large, can be very harsh debate in Europe about the European Stability Mechanism, the ESM, because especially the country with the bigger debt versus the GDP, and unfortunately, is Italy. But Italy is the first one to have a large debt. They have asked to loosen the ESM constraints. This is not by someone is not considered enough. We are asking again, as was made after World War II, to create a corona bond issued by the ECB as a long-term bond to refinance the reconstruction. Because what we expect, unfortunately, is a real reconstruction of the economy. And this is a major debate, harsh, and we have, as usual, two different opponents, the northern country, which are, as usual, more savvy, and except Germany, that are even smaller. And then we have the southern countries, but this time France is part of it, because it's every day we read and we listen to the debates, and as usual, it's not easy to understand what will be the end. Clearly, Europe this time, as a continent, can suffer, can be severely wounded. Hopefully not, but there is a big issue, because any government has to deal with internal and domestic issues, but this time is not easy to work on its own. Before leaving some room to the questions, let me tell you that not only Europe and United States have thought of stimulus, but most of the countries in the world, like China, South Korea, Japan, and Russia, and Australia, have announced and deliberated a number of economic stimulus. Of course, for instance, China, who has been the first to announce the COVID virus, and maybe they are the cause, as Mr. Trump liked to say, the China virus, has implemented a $250 billion loan to support banks to allow them to keep granting loans to companies. The reserve requirements have been lowered. China is by far, like United States, they have ability to access such a huge amount of cash. And then people, they are able to suffer as in the United States. So I believe that they will overcome pretty easily. Even South Korea announced a $10 billion stimulus package at the beginning of this month to subsidize small and medium business. Japan has passed two packages for small business loans for around $20 billion. Russia, again, $4 billion fund. Australia, that was passed, will spend $130 billion of Australian dollars, which is $80 billion over the next months, to protect jobs. So even in the Principality of Monaco, there is a program to support the business, because here all the major businesses are closed. So hotels, restaurants, and we have few, every day used to come to Monaco, around 40,000, Marco, am I wrong? 25 from France, 16 from Italy, workers. Now this is everybody is, most of them at home, jobless. So is unpredictable, which is shall be the final end. It's true that we are living moments that we are not absolutely expected to live, because even now it's not clear again I've been advisor to the Ministry of Health in Italy for many years, so I still have contact with the state, the government organizations. We are all the world is still a little bit far away from a vaccine against the virus. It's true that thanks to the experience that everybody is doing in the world, we have found a number of drugs who can help to fight the illness. So we haven't found something to fight the cause, but we have found the illness which attack the lungs and the respiratory system. So everything who can be considered as an immunologist is to defend the respiratory system. I believe that, of course, confinement is not an easy, very difficult in the United States, especially in the big city, but we have a stay-home policy, and I have to make my respectful thank you to Fordham leaders, because Fordham has acted wisely and very responsibly in advance even to the government decision, and has been great, because you need to be courageous and determined to make this type of choice. But this is the only way to keep for some months the faculty, all the stakeholders and the students away from this horrible situation. I'm sorry, it's not enough. I'm used to do some nicer address, so no space, but now was okay. I will finish with my question to Mr. Casiraghi. Marco, do you think that this global turmoil will affect the sense of sustainable economy? So I remember what you told me a few times. To make a sustainable choice is not necessarily more expensive to a traditional choice. You can confirm it? You can tell us something about that, please?
Yeah, but as I mentioned, there are really, in fact, out of this purgatory, to really go back to the paradise of growth, there are two ways. And definitely one is a better way, and the other one is an old way that repeat some of the previous sins. Unfortunately, the two roads, they exist. It is possible to definitely go under a road that does not really require much more resources than the other. Unfortunately, there is still the possibility that due to the fact that we are used to go on a copy and paste, that we go the old way. And consequently, we don't pay proper attention. And this is a question of knowledge that obviously the fact that you need to know that this technology exists to be able to apply it. You need to have the technician, the people that is able to use it. Some people are are able, some other don't really want to do it. Some people may not have the interest, because sometimes what is happening is the fact that somebody who built something doesn't pay for the running cost. And consequently, if you have a possibility, but this is true for also domestic appliance. You can buy a refrigerator that is a higher class, in a sense that consume less energy, but it costs a little bit more. And similarly, you're going to recuperate through the year what you pay initially. So consequently, apparently you spend initially more, but you save more later. So consequently, it's just a question, and this is true now for refrigerator, for washing machine, for your air conditioning. So you have really to check and ask for those alternatives, what they really mean. When you put your condensing unit outside in the United States, those round kind of small equipment that you have in the garden, what is the energy efficiency ratio? It's called EER, and really compare to what you are paying and see what the payback is. This for consumer, for individual, and also for larger thing, and I was mentioning on the fact that is our role in the board of the company when we have to approve a certain type of investment, really to ask for alternative, and what are the difference if we have a more efficient energy solution. And so it's just a question of really pushing, being a little bit hard with engineers, asking for alternative. And this means also a little bit more work from our side in the board to really oblige the people to examine in detail what are the options, and being able to push for really seeing, and don't leave the decision without having really understood what are the alternatives. So it is possible. It is possible to do, and some have been done. So there is no doubt that versus 2008, 2009, today we are living in a more efficient world. In 2008, you can probably buy only a Toyota as a hybrid car. Today, you have a much bigger choice. So I have some friend, American friend in Chicago, that they have bought the new X5 hybrid plug-in, and he's commuting, going to work every day. But he said that in the last 6 months, he has barely done very little gas into the tank, because the house is loaded up during the night. And when he goes in the office, he just plug in again, and he recharges his car and he comes back. Now the autonomy of available, you can buy this car. You cannot buy this car 10 years ago. So it's just a question to do it. The differential in cost is not so high. And when you see what has happened to the pollution in the Po River, there are also some this is evidence, is there. So it's just a question of pushing. And it's also our responsibility as a board member to ask and to push in that direction. Technology exists.
Great. Thank you, Mr. Casiraghi. Thank you, Mr. Mennillo. And so we'll just open it up for questions. I guess my just initial thought is that, as Mr. Mennillo said, one of the repercussions of this virus is change of behavior. And obviously this could impact, certainly in the short term, the cruise industry, right? This change, and hopefully the change of behavior will change over the long term, et cetera. And that's one question. But the second question for the corporate boards, hopefully this virus will allow people to maybe take a second look at their lives and be grateful for their health and be grateful for the planet that they're on. And hopefully that could change behaviors as well, in terms of the use of more sustainable methods moving forward. So hopefully that is a repercussion of the virus. But so we can open it up if anyone has any questions for either Mr. Mennillo or Mr. Casiraghi. You could also send it on the queue as well.
I have a question, if there's no students that have one. This is Dr. Megan Drury-Grogan. I'm an associate professor in our communication and media management area. So I thank you both, Mr. Mennillo and Mr. Casiraghi. I appreciate your time and your insights that you're sharing with us and with the students today. And you were talking about technologies we use as well as behaviors we change. I wonder if you have some examples of specific behaviors on an individual level that you think need to change as a result of the crisis we're in, and in particular because it's a health-related crisis and not just a financial crisis or a crisis that evolved from a wartime situation, if you will.
Let me tell you, I'll make an example because I'm sure that Marco will follow me. For instance, very popular in our life these times are mall that they have become over the years not only a place where to make shopping, because shopping for instance clothes have been more and more moved to internet, but they have become just a gathering place. Most of the mall, they have food providers. I believe that this is an area of real estate will suffer a lot. For how long some of us will go to a mall, or some of our students will go to a mall, staying with a lot of people packed just to have a beer. If you are in the proper age, or to have a drink, or to have a bite. Well, let me tell you, I'm sure that people will think about it. And you can imagine this will have an impact on the value of a movie theater. Was already a type of business that was suffering. Now, who's gonna go in place where you are supposed to gather? It's not easy. And especially, Megan, in Dublin, you have such a wonderful place and pubs that I've seen always a lot of young people flowing. They will bear in mind what's happening. And I believe that for a long time, the life, the social life, will be deteriorated. Of course, I strongly, because what's going to happen in October? It will be a rebound of the virus. What kind of winter we will have? Because now it's clear summer. What's going to happen? Now, we're starting having some figures from Africa. What's going to happen? So I believe that this stuff will this plague. I agree. It's of course with Francis, and I hope with we share the faith, and I know with you as well, Megan. It's a moment not easy. Not easy, because we as a human being, we understand our limits and the respect of nature. So to have a social responsible behavior in the business and a sustainable business, respecting the world, it will become more and more a must to respect.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Now, you were asking for if I see some example now. Now is a little bit too early to really see. We are still in the middle. What I can see today is more evidence. Now, even in the Po Valley today, you have really a major decrease in the ranges of 20-30% of the nitrogen oxide that are suspended in the air, and especially in the small soot particle that really are dangerous for your health. And this is known. And also now we see that this is not happening. Now, the fact of an electric car that at this point do not produce local pollution. Now you have the evidence. So I hope that since now the product is available for different ranges, people will move more toward that type of existing product. Now it's too early really to say that they will move in that direction. And obviously, when you see that, I don't know what in the state with the oil at $23 a barrel will be the cost of a tank of a gallon of gasoline, but maybe it will be around half what is today. So consequently, some of the people will really run again happy the old way. But at the same time, I am also confident that more people will really see the impact and they will go more. The trend is already there. So this is an opportunity to push this trend. And this depends from some government choice and some communication done in a proper way. For sure, some industry, as Andrea, will change. There is no doubt that before the invention of the mechanical refrigerator back 100 years ago, or even less, maybe even 70, or in a developed country, there was a big production of ice. So there was not, each home was without his own domestic refrigerator. And obviously some industry has really totally changed. If you go back in 1800, there was a transport by ship of block of ice. And that is a business that has disappeared. So some other businesses will suffer. Personally, I am convinced that boys and girls will like to meet in person, because certain type of thing you cannot do it on internet. So consequently, life will go back, and people will meet in the bar, and also they will go to the mall. Some other businesses will be affected more clearly. And now the point, I'm back on the fact that from a business point of view, or also even as a member of the community, we need to push for the right direction. And for business people, we need to be able to see and push certain type of behavior. There will be some other changes. For sure, the supply chain will have an impact, because people in this day are discovering how important it is to have two or three suppliers and some closer to your own business. Right. And consequently, today, supply chain is disrupted. China is still shipping a lot less than what, despite they're almost out. So consequently, some changes will occur.
Thank you.
But I am overall, I tend to be positive that maybe it will take a year, maybe it will take two, but bar will be still full of boys and girls.
There's hope. Thank you.
Yes, definitely.
Thank you, Mr. Casiraghi and Mr. Mennillo. My name is Claire Mukolwe-Galazini. I just joined the Ember team working with Lucia and Dr. Francis Petit just before the virus, the COVID-19 virus happened. So my question, or rather a comment, I just wanted to first of all, really appreciate the magnitude of and depth of your explanation, Mr. Mennillo, because I think before, are you getting feedback? I don't know.
Yes, I can hear you.
Oh, you can hear me, okay. So I think I didn't, until this presentation, I didn't actually really see the depth of the impact of the small, medium, and large impact on market capitalization for companies. And it's quite scary to think about. But you kept saying, you know, you're telling us all about all the gloom and doom that's coming back and forth. But I think there's one thing that we can probably appreciate, the fact that as opposed to having trading floors where people had to go and physically be on trading floors, we now have electronic forms of electronic trading platforms. And I think as a result of that, during this era, it will probably help to keep people working. But again, it's a little bit difficult to see when you talk about companies and how much work they're able to change, what's moving in terms of market cap and different sectors, the moving parts in different sectors. There are people that need to do that work. And I just wonder, from your perspective, how that is going to be managed, because not everybody is able to fully participate to help make things happen in the economy. So do you have any comments in that regard?
Thank you for your question, because we are living in Europe, because Europe feels more harsher the impact so far on of the plague. We have our heroes now, as in the United States, you had the firemen are the doctors and the nurses, because you can imagine these people, and we still have a big toll of debt among them. They keep working to heal and support the people sick, the sick people, and unfortunately, some of them they die. We in Italy is part of our huge and maybe one of the most important literature in the world. We have a very famous novel, The Promessi Sposi by Manzoni, and he's talking about the big plague who hit north of Italy and most of Europe in 17th century. And there are a number of stories, story of love, story of faith, and it's made one of the most known and successful novel ever written. And it's talking about the people working in the lazaretto, where the place where people with the plague were healed, and a lot of people died. Yes, today, you know, the people is working, the people related to the food industry, because a primary point is to supply the people with the food. People in the health system and people in the security system. But now, for instance, a very important industry, which is the communication, I say trains or planes, is completely shut down. It's not that you are not allowed to take trains, you are not allowed to take, what's going to happen to the airline industry? If of course they will rebound, because I belong to a group of people who used to take 200-300 planes a year, so of course I will get back, but it's not so easy. We need time. The industry will be reshaped. Unfortunately, there are no answers today the situation is still evolving. We have some good news. We have some good news because Italy, after China, is showing an improving after the confinement. We are now after 3 days, 4 days that we have a declining of people who has been infected and of the death toll. But what's happening in Spain is devastating. It's devastating. They don't have room in the cemetery. So, you know, in Europe, it's not easy to accept it. We've been living in this land for the last 5,000-6,000 years. People, of course, we passed through wars and decimation, but it's a complex situation. And we were completely unprepared, our health system. So far, I discussed with that about that this morning with Mr. Casiraghi. Germany, who has used to have the best ratio in Europe with the 26 intensive care beds every 100,000 people, the figures who came out, they are still manageable. Italy was the second one. With, I think, 17 or 18 beds every 100,000 people. If we follow this statistic, we don't expect the good from Great Britain, which is one of the worst in Europe. So we don't know. Sorry, we try to... We have to get back to our faith. We have to fight as much as we can, but we have to accept. We have an expression in my hometown, Naples, one of the oldest cities in the world. The night has to finish. We have to wait that the night has to finish. And maybe a long time we start to see. I don't see a lot of light. And I have a wonderful view from my apartment. But the night has to finish. We have to be patient and be have faith that it will finish. And of course, human being with the strong values and ethics and a good education, this is for the students, we will find a way to recovery. But I'm sorry, I don't think that the night is already over. We have to wait.
Thank you.
Yes, but if you can add something is that we will be better at the end of this night. Definitely better. If you see, you go back in history, the plague that affected Europe in the 1600 was less severe than what happened in the 1300, where one third of the population of Europe died. During the, I think it was 1350, something around that. So consequently, after we have definitely improved, and over here, even if some of the numbers are really terrible, but I'm sure that we will be better because we have learned, and for sure, all of the logistic, the stockpiling, the procedure in a different country will be improved. At the same time, we need to analyze and enact, learn from this experience. And from a business point of view, we need really to see which business will be affected, make some choice, take some bet also in some of that direction. And I was looking because tomorrow I have a board meeting of a company who is in Philadelphia. They are making flexible packaging for food. And I was looking at their material for tomorrow meeting. And in fact, so far, they are supplier of flexible packaging, particularly for coffee, they are supplier of Starbucks and so on, or flexible packaging. And so I was asking, and I will ask even more tomorrow, but the indication are that being in the food industry, the level of effect on their business is relatively small. In fact, there are in some area there are even increase of order. Consequently, they are not affected in terms of volume and in terms of production. Obviously, they have changed, they've introduced some new procedure to try to protect their worker, even if they are a little bit slowed down by some legal constraint, because there are some people who don't want their temperature to be taken even with with an infrared thermometer, but they have introduced some rule, and consequently, again, at the end, it will be tougher, it's not finished, but at the end, we will be better.
Well, thank you. Wonderful words of advice from Mr. Mennillo and Mr. Casiraghi. And just to kind of bring it to a close, we're very grateful. We're very grateful for your time and your contribution to the Gabelli School of Business. And we've had throughout the session, I was looking. We had over 100 students and visitors on the queue listening and learning. So I am very grateful for your contribution and for being here. I guess one last thing is any final words of advice to our students.
As I was by far, I'm sure, perceived as a pessimistic, I would like to finish with what I've done on the investment side in the last few hours. I'm selecting investment instruments who have, of course, suffered. Like bonds or subordinated loans from financial institution, because I am positive that after this purge, we will have a stronger and healthier financial system. So if we are selective, we have a lot of opportunity without taking advantage from the bad, but we have to take advantage of our ability to select, to our wisdom, to understand the change, and to take this opportunity. So keep your eyes open, think. Use the tools that your faculty have been providing to you. And this is, as some of you wrote me, the night will be over. Sooner or later will be over. There is no way.
Okay, so from my side, first I want to thank you to give me the occasion to share some of the experience and some of the view with so many of your students that you mentioned. As a final point of advice, we're just thinking on a final message that I think is quite important for our students, for our children, and that I think is something that recollect, I'm going back to what was happening many years ago when I was spending some time during the summer vacation, in particular with my grandmother, myself and my sister, who is a couple of years younger than me. In Italy, it's quite common that you go and you spend at least 1 month with your grandparent. And I remember that especially my sister, who was really, sometimes she was not wanted to eat all the food that was in the plate. And I still remember my grandmother telling my sister to eat and to finish what was on the plate. And one example that she was always saying was, my sister is called Rosalba, was saying, Rosalba, you have to eat what you have in the plate, because there are really millions of people and he was saying in China, in Africa, in some of the developing countries, who do not have this food. So you cannot waste your food. Eat Rosalba, eat Rosalba, was a typical advice. In this moment, if I have to paraphrase and change the advice to our own children, in the developed country, like we are really so lucky of being really born in country like state or like Europe, my advice is study, be good, be damn good in what you're doing, because there are millions of people who want your job in the future. From some of the developing countries, you tend to study and work harder than what we do. So consequently, my advice is study. And apply, you will have really a possibility to enjoy and making a better world if you have a good knowledge of what is going on.
Thank you both. Thank you very much. I guess on behalf of the Gabelli School business, I first want to thank Mr. Casiraghi for being a part of it and for your words of wisdom, and to be part of International Business Week. And on behalf of the Gabelli School of Business, I want to thank Mr. Mennillo for all your contributions to not only the advisory board, but to the Fordham London Centre, and certainly for your friendship, and Mr. Casiraghi, our new friendship. So I'd like to thank you both. And I also want to wish you and your families positive health and safety, as well as the participants here and the Fordham students and the Fordham stakeholders. So I wish everyone positive health. If there's not a final word, we can officially end the session. So I just, anything else before we end?
God bless you all.
Yes.
Thank you. Bye everybody. Thank you. Bye.
Thank you everybody. And thanks again for participating. Thank you.